Welcome to the Myeloma University module titled How Treatments Are Selected for Patients with Multiple Myeloma. My name is Beth Faiman and I am a nurse practitioner at the Taussig Cancer Institute in Cleveland, Ohio. In this short discussion, we will review the basics of treatment selection in the upfront and relapse settings and the importance of disease monitoring. Now let's begin. Before we review how treatments are selected in myeloma, I think it's important to briefly review the history of treatment in multiple myeloma to demonstrate just how far we've come in the way of numerous and complex treatment options. In 1962, melphalan was found to produce remission in about a third of patients with multiple myeloma. Just a few years later, it was shown that high doses of glucocorticosteroids, such as prednisone, could induce remissions in patients with refractory or relapsing myeloma. In 1972, the efficacy of melphalan and prednisone as in a combination was seen. Now, various clinical trials were undertaken through the years that subsequently followed, but no single therapy was found to be highly effective in controlling myeloma. Fortunately, in 1999, the anti-tumor activity of thalidomide in refractory multiple myeloma was reported, which changed the course of treatment for multiple myeloma patients globally. In the 2000s and until now, numerous drug trials using novel drugs with new mechanisms of action such as immunomodulatory agents, proteasome inhibitors, and monoclonal antibodies provided hope for patients with multiple myeloma as treatment options were limited and stagnant for 35 plus years. Life expectancy with myeloma after diagnosis continues to improve today. Currently, numerous agents with complex mechanisms of action have been approved, and promising ongoing trials are giving patients with myeloma new therapeutic options. Now, upfront therapy for multiple myeloma is often divided into the induction, consolidation, and maintenance phases. Induction therapy generally induces a remission and is generally 4 to 6 cycles of treatment before a planned transplant to consolidate a remission. Most commonly, patients are offered a 3-drug combination of an immunomodulatory drug such as lenalidomide, a proteasome inhibitor such as bortezomib or carfilzomib, and a corticosteroid such as dexamethasone. There are also data to support 4-drug regimens adding in a monoclonal antibody to treat newly diagnosed myeloma. The type and duration of induction therapy varies according to genetic risk status, fitness or frailty, and how deep of a remission one wants to achieve. For those who are frail or less fit, many myeloma practitioners will give 6 to 8 cycles of induction therapy, then de-escalate therapy, going right into a maintenance phase. For patients who are fit, a stem cell transplant will often be recommended. Please tune into the stem cell transplant and maintenance modules for more information on these topics. What are some of the considerations then when discussing treatment? First, a clinical trial participation is preferred if one is eligible to participate in a well-designed trial and willing. One's lifestyle and quality of life should also be considered when treatment is discussed. Does this patient have a caregiver, or are they a caregiver to an elderly spouse or a sick child? Or will full-time employment interrupt study visits? For patients with previously treated myeloma, previous treatments, if any, also factors that might factor into the treatment they might receive, such as peripheral neuropathy from drugs, or maybe the disease didn't respond as well to this therapy. What worked, what didn't work, and what were the side effects experienced? If a patient risks to delay a transplant up front, a patient may be reconsidered for a stem cell transplant at a later date should their situation change. It is important for all patients to have a consultation with a myeloma specialist for shared decision making. Shared decision making occurs when doctors, nurses, advanced practice providers take into account clinical experience, data from research, and patient preference to arrive at a final decision. As a member of the healthcare team, nurses can promote participation in clinical trials and encourage consultation with a myeloma specialist and remind patients that treatments will change throughout the course of the disease. Regardless of the treatment given at diagnosis or relapse, nurses should be aware of monitoring for remission and relapse. How do we know if patients are in remission, and how do we monitor for relapse? While the International Myeloma Working Group has established response criteria for multiple myeloma patients undergoing treatment, taking into account paraprotein studies as discussed in the previous testing module. The International Myeloma Working Group response criteria is not only used in the context of clinical trials, but can also be used in a day-to-day setting to follow one's remission status. When treatment has begun, either a diagnosis or relapse, you can expect to see at least a 50% reduction in the serum paraproteins. This is called a PR or partial response. Deeper responses will be seen over time in most patients. A VGPR, or a very good partial response, occurs when there is a 90% reduction in a serum or urine myeloma paraprotein study. Now we have newer response criteria, which adds additional layers of categories of complete or stringent complete remission, which can detect even minimal residual disease, or MRD. That is less than 1 in a million malignant plasma cells within the bone marrow microenvironment. In the past, we couldn't imagine such deep remissions were available with the earlier therapies. A goal of therapy currently is to be able to eliminate all the malignant clones in the bone marrow as best possible. The key concepts are that deeper remissions generally mean longer remissions and disease-free intervals, as well as better patient outcomes. There are many ways to get deeper responses, such as multi-drug regimens and stem cell transplant. Even remaining on maintenance therapy for a longer period of time can induce a deeper remission. Multiple myeloma is a relapsing disease. The malignant clones of normal cells that comprise the majority of the myeloma cells change over time. The malignant myeloma clone that caused organ damage at diagnosis but was treated and eradicated by initial therapy is literally not the same biologic disease after the patient has undergone multiple rounds of therapy. Therefore, continuous therapy should be recommended and encouraged, and adherence strategies should be discussed at diagnosis and throughout to emphasize that not only is this a chronic condition, the goal of treatment suppressing malignant clones to achieve a better balance of quality of life and quantity of life to live well and longer than ever. Nurses should set expectations for ongoing treatment as a valuable part of the treatment team and support patients through side effects and adherence strategies such as helping schedule appointments and facilitate medication refills. Nurses should also ensure disease monitoring with CBC, CMP, SPEP, free light chains, and monoclonal studies are obtained on a regular basis at the discretion of the treatment team. I generally monitor these labs on a monthly basis, especially during the first year of therapy. Then, when one attains an excellent remission, labs can be checked every 2 or 3 months, depending on one's disease status or remission status and the type of maintenance therapy they are receiving. In this module, we discussed how treatments are selected for patients with myeloma and the importance of regular disease monitoring, including the types of tests and frequency of testing. Thank you for joining me today to share in this discussion. For more information, please see these additional resources and watch for additional segments in this series. Thank you.